In this problem, we're trying to figure out what this factor group is isomorphic to. That's the external direct product of Z4 with Z12. This is a cyclic subgroup generated by 2, 2. Might be, not be a bad idea to, as you start the problem solving process, of thinking about how big these individual groups are. Here we have external direct product of Z4 and Z12 as a set. That's the set of all ordered pairs. First element from Z4, second element from Z12. That's supposed to be a 12 there. There's four choices for A, the first component, 0, 1, 2, and 3. And 12 choices for B, the second component, 0 through 11. Yes, so you have 4 times 12. 48 elements in that group. As far as the cyclic subgroup generated by 2, 2, that's not so clear how big that's going to be. So you'd want to figure out what elements are in there. Certainly the identity is. The group operation is addition, so 0, 0 is the identity, not 1, 1. Next, let's put this element 2, 2 that is generating this cyclic subgroup. Then keep track in your mind, what is the operation? You add these quote-unquote vectors component-wise. Add 2, 2 to itself. The first component needs to be added mod 4, and the second component mod 12, so we get 0, 4 when we simplify. Let's do the rest in our heads. So that's 2, 2 plus itself. Add on another 2, 2, you'll get 2, 6. Add on another 2, 2, 2 plus 2 is 4, mod 4 is 0, 6 plus 2 is 8, mod 12 is still 8. Modding the second component by 12. Keep going. There's just two more elements. We get 2, 10 for the next one, and then 4, 12, which becomes 0, 0 when we mod by 4 and 12, but I don't need to rewrite it because I already wrote it. Doesn't hurt to write it, rewrite it, by the way, right? With sets, you can rewrite elements and it's still the same set. But just to clearly emphasize in our mind, this has got 6 elements. Let's not rewrite it. Therefore, this element has order 6, and also the cyclic subgroup it generates has order 6. Therefore, I mean, the book gives you a big hint about this ahead of time, but if you didn't know it, therefore, this factor group has 48 divided by 6 elements. It's got 8 elements. The order of the factor group, which you can write like this, is the same as the index of the subgroup in the bigger group, right? Because the index in chapter 7 about Lagrange's theorem is by definition the number of left cosets or right cosets, but the elements of the factor group are cosets. So by definition, this is the index. Well, yeah, by definition of the factor group, this is the index. This is seems funny to write, but it's consistent with what we know so far. And by Lagrange's theorem, that's the same as the order of the entire group divided by the order of the subgroup, which is 48 divided by 6 or 8. And again, the book tells you there's 3 possible choices that all do have order 8. So you would know this without doing what I did here. So I imagine on your homework, you didn't do this, and that's fine. But if the book didn't give you that hint of what the possibilities were, this is something you'd want to do to make sure you realize that this thing has 8 elements. It is abelian as well. Z4, this external direct product with Z12 is abelian. Any factor group of an abelian group will be an abelian group. Suppose that could be a proof on the test. Is it hard to prove? If G is abelian, well, any subgroup of G will be normal. That's true and pretty easy to prove. So you can form the factor group that will be abelian as well. This is abelian. What would the proof be like? Take two cosets, do they commute? Use the definition of coset multiplication and use the fact that G is abelian. Yeah, it's pretty trivial. They commute. Probably too easy for the test, but is something worth realizing is true. So this has got to be an abelian group. Chapter 11, which we haven't talked about yet, is called the Fundamental Theorem of Finite Abelian Groups. It's about classifying finite abelian groups. If you know you have an abelian group of order 8, turns out there's only three possible things it can be isomorphic to. Let's call this group, let's go ahead and call this thing G here. So G is abelian with order 8. Therefore, G is isomorphic to three possibilities by this fundamental theorem of finite abelian groups, which I haven't written down yet. So I'm not fully explaining this. It's isomorphic either to Z8, cyclic, or the external direct product with Z4 and Z2, or the external direct product of Z2 with itself having three Z2s in here. Those are the three distinct isomorphism classes that G could have. One of those three. And your problem was, which one is it? This is the cyclic one. These two are non-cyclic. None of these is isomorphic to any of the other ones because the numbers, the subscripts, are not relatively prime. Right? Z2 external direct product with Z3, for example, 2 and 3 are relatively prime, so that is cyclic. That's isomorphic to Z6. But 2 and 4 are not relatively prime. That's not isomorphic to Z8. It's a distinct isomorphism class. And that's pretty trivial to think about if you think about orders of elements. Z8 has, for example, four elements of order 8. These two have no elements of order 8. If you think about the LCM approach. This has got elements of order 4. This doesn't have any elements of order 4. So they're definitely distinct isomorphism classes. And it turns out these are the only possibilities. So which one is it? That was your problem. The book's got an example. Maybe you found where they kind of give a slick argument for another situation somewhat similar to this. Probably when you're problem solving for the first time, a problem like this, you're not going to think of a slick argument. Probably you just need to do a calculations on scratchwork and then put those calculations nicely on the paper that you turn in. Try figuring out some elements and their orders. If you find an element of order 8, you know the answer has got to be Z8. If you don't find an element of order 8, it's got to be one of these two. And in fact, if you don't find an element of order 4, it's got to be that one. So it's just a matter of experimentation, though you do need to understand what you're doing as far as what the elements of this factor group are. They are cosets written with plus signs because the group operation is addition. There again is the subgroup that we are modding by to think about left cosets here and representatives in front of the H, go ahead and call this H, Don't pick one of these elements. If you pick one of those to be the thing in front of the H, the coset representative, it's going to be trivial. It's going to be the identity element. It'll have order one. So don't pick one of those. Pick something else like oh, I don't know, 1, 1. What is the order of 1, 1 plus H? Well, add it to itself. 1, 1 plus H, add it to itself. I'm using addition because, again, the group operation is addition. The book in their example did do something a little confusing at this point. Maybe that might have been one of your big sources of confusion in trying to do this problem. In the book's example, they did use exponent notation here. I think that's too confusing. The group operations addition, they should not have used exponent notation. This 4 should have been in front as a multiple to see that you get this. Or we don't even have to use that notation at all. We can just think about adding this thing to itself. What do you get? You got to add the representatives. 1, 1 plus 1, 1. Oops, I keep writing H's. Plus H. Which is 2, 2 plus H. Careful. Is this the identity or not? Is this H or not? It is the identity because 2, 2's in H. It gets sucked in, right? Giant slurping sound. That's H. Therefore, the order of 1, 1 plus H is 2. All right, try 1, 0 plus H. 1, 0 added to itself. 1, 0 plus H is 2, 0 plus H. Is this the identity coset? Is 2, 0 in H or not? That's how you tell. It's not. So this is not the identity coset. Therefore, you have ruled out something. We've ruled out that one. Because the order of this is going to be bigger than 2. This is not the identity. 2, 0 is not an H, so it doesn't get sucked in. If I do this to itself 3 times, I'll go ahead and write the 3 here. This means adding this to itself with 3 terms. I get 3, 0 plus H, and I don't have to do any modding. Because the first component is mod 4, the second mod 12, I can leave it like this. That's also not equal to H either, as it has to not be because of Lagrange's theorem, right? This group has order 8. You can't have an element of order 3. Does it have order 4? Here we get 4, 0 plus H, but the first element there, you got to mod the first component by 4. This is really 0, 0 plus H. 0, 0 is an H. This equals H. Therefore, this element, 1, 0 plus H, has order 4. I had to do that step right there because I had to think about modding the first component by 4. So found an element of order 4. Are there any elements of order 8? That would take experimentation. I hope it feels intuitive that they're probably not. Because the Z4 there probably. Maybe we can do something like this. Maybe we can do something slick like the book does. And think about, for example, doing 4 times any coset. Adding any coset to itself with 4 terms. without modding, you would get 4a, 4b plus h. But then modding, oh yeah, this does it. Modding the first component by 4, no matter what a is going to give you 0. No matter what a is, that first component is going to be 0. And so I believe this does it. Does this equal h? The question is, are all elements of first component 0 and second component a multiple of 4, meaning 0, 4, or 8, in h? Yes, they are. There, there, and there. And therefore, no matter what a and b are, this equals h. It's the identity. So the upshot of this is that there's no elements of order 8. The biggest order can be 4. You do have elements of order 2. This is still true for elements of order 2. We also do have at least one element of order 4. There would be more of them. Therefore, the answer is that one.